Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the 2006 AERA Annual Meeting Program Chair, William Tate.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the American Educational Research Association's award presentations and presidential address. This session provides a unique opportunity to recognize the outstanding contributions that our colleagues have made to educational research in service to our research community. I am both excited and pleased to share this experience with the awardees and our association president. This year's program theme, Education Research in the Public Interest, is reflected in the research and scholarship being recognized today. This should not be shocking. The aim of research and education, and public interest research in particular, is to offer a response to the most challenging problems and to advance a sound and coherent evidentiary base on matters of human development broadly defined. Scholars who have helped us better understand and resolve the most difficult and social challenges will share this stage today. The annual meeting is a forum for sharing various iterations of our research and thinking. This forum would not be feasible without appropriate infrastructure and significant human investment. I would like to take a moment to thank a select group of colleagues who have made this event possible. First, let me begin with my fellow program chairs and divisional and SIG leaders. Your leadership and guidance are foundational and reflected in the essence of the program. Second, I would like to thank each of you that served as a reviewer. A professional research society cannot function without peer review. Third, I would like to thank the AERA team led by Felice Levine. I offer a special thanks to Robert Smith, Phoebe Stevenson, and James Mears. I work with many, many others in the AERA team who made important contributions to the development of this ever-growing enterprise. Thank you. Please note that this meeting has had the largest registration in AERA history. The numbers appear to be over 15,000. We're the largest. Yeah. With also the largest on-site registration in the history of this organization. This should help the membership, you, better understand the scale and scope of work required. Finally, I would like to thank Gloria Ladson-Billings for entrusting me with this responsibility. As we celebrate the accomplishments of association members, it is vitally important that we thoughtfully reflect on and remember our colleagues who have died in this past year. Please join me in a moment of silence. The names appear on the view screen. At this point, I would like to turn to the introduction of our award recipients. The first award that would be given today is the Palmer O. Johnson Memorial Award. And the person who introduced that award will be Jomills Henry Braddock II.
Thank you. In recognition of the contributions to educational research of Palmer O. Johnson, this award highlights outstanding articles published in one of AERA's academic journals. On behalf of the AERA, I'm pleased to announce this year's winner. This year's award goes to Professor Cynthia E. Coburn of the University of California at Berkeley, for her article, The Role of Non-System Actors in the relationship between policy and practice, the case of reading instruction in California. This article was published in Educational Evaluation and Policy Analysis. In your program, you have a description of the article, which I won't read, time doesn't permit, but the awards committee believes that this study well represents the impressive tradition of the Palmer O. Johnson Memorial Award. Would you please join me in recognizing Professor Cynthia Coburn?
Thank you very much. I want to thank AERA. This has been a wonderful surprise and a great honor to receive this kind of recognition of my work. The study that is in the article is actually a reanalysis of some of my dissertation data, so I want to thank the people that made that work possible. I had a wonderful committee at Stanford University, including Milbury McLaughlin, Joan Talbert, Larry Cuban, and Dick Scott. I also want to thank the Spencer Foundation, who gave me a dissertation fellowship that allowed me to do something much more ambitious than I otherwise would have been able to do. And I want to thank just the wonderful community of graduate students that I went through that experience with. Their thinking and their questions have continued to inform my work. I want to thank the two institutions that I've been at since graduating, the University of Pittsburgh, where I wrote this paper. And I'd like to thank UC Berkeley, which is my current home, and whose really wonderful intellectual community continues to feed my work as I take it to the next place. And one of the really great things about this AERA being in San Francisco this year is it means that significant members of my family are able to be here with me today. They're sort of over that way. So I want to especially thank my sister Kara and my partner Nathan McBrien. They are nothing short of my best friends, and they're extremely tolerant of the amount that I work, and they give me a lot of reasons not to continue to work, to take some breaks. In particular, I want to thank Nathan, who reads just about every word that I write, and he pushes my thinking in really productive and provocative ways, and I'm just very grateful that I have them and that they were able to be here today. So thanks very much.
Thomas Barone will introduce the award winner, the Review of Research Award winner.
The Review of Educational Research Awards Committee has selected the recipient of the 2006 award. The other members of the committee included Dr. Lisa Mazet of Ohio Dominican University, Dr. Barbara Schneider of Michigan State, Dr. Olga Welch of Duquesne University. The article we selected appeared in the fall 2005 issue of Review of Educational Research, and it's entitled Socioeconomic Status and Academic Achievement, a Meta-Analytical Review of Educational Research, of Educational Research. And the author is Selçuk R. Şirin.
I feel so honored to have the AERA recognize my work, and I am especially touched because the topic of the article is something I deeply care about. There are many people that helped make this paper possible. This also was a dissertation. So the members of my dissertation committee who are not here are Jackie Lerner, Penny Hauser Kram, Dave Bluestein, and Al Beaton, all from Boston College. And I also would like to thank two of my mentors who are, I hope that they are here today, Dr. Mary Brabeck and Dr. Michelle Fine. Mary was one of the first people who encouraged me to do this work at the very beginning. I'm ever grateful for her continued support. Michelle Fine's work has always inspired my own research on access and equality, and I'm privileged to have her as my neighbor and collaborator over the years. Finally, I would like to thank my wife, Dr. Lauren Rajesh Şirin, for her constant love and intellectual support. Thank you all.
The Relating Research to Practice Award will be presented by Stephen White.
The Relating Research to Practice Award Professional Service recognizes an individual who has effectively established a strong beneficial relationship between educational research and practice through direct involvement with the educational community. The Relating Research to Practice Award committee members this year were Sharon Nelson Barber, Geneva Gay, Sharon Lewis, and James Lytle. The recipient of the 2006 Relating Research to Practice Award for Professional Service is Dr. Thomas Guskey of the University of Kentucky. Dr. Guskey's selection was based on his involvement with educators in school districts, regional service centers, and education agencies, and members of the National Staff Development Council. For over 15 years, he has helped staff development leaders throughout the United States and several foreign countries bridge the gap between educational research and practice. His work includes publications that have provided an alternative view of the teacher change process, linked educator staff development experiences with student learning outcomes, outlined a staff development evaluation model, and presented perspectives on the most promising ideas in staff development. Congratulations, Dr. Guskey.
I'd like to thank Steve and the other members of the award committee for this wonderful honor. I consider this to be one of AERA's most prestigious awards. I was raised in the northeastern part of the United States, and in that part of the country we have a common road sign that reads, "Bridges freeze before road surfaces." And I've always thought of that as an appropriate metaphor, the relationship between the community of researchers and the community of practitioners. We do a much better job of communicating within our community than we do bridging and building bridges between those communities. There is, though, in this organization a growing number of individuals who work hard to build those bridges and facilitate the communication between those communities, those who do their very best to keep those pathways of communication open, who see the significance of each other's work, and do the really difficult task of trying to take the complex, the meaningful ideas that come about in meetings like this and translate it into meaningful but simple ways that overburdened practitioners can not only understand, but then use in good and meaningful ways to help students learn better and then gain the many positive benefits of that success. I'm proud to be a member of that group, and I'm very proud to be a part of an organization that honors that work. Thank you.
The E.F. Lindquist Award will be presented by Nancy Peterson.
The E.F. Lindquist Award was named in honor of an outstanding scholar and researcher and is granted annually by AERA and ACT in recognition of outstanding research in the field of testing and measurement, with particular emphasis given to research that has advanced the companion goals of greater understanding and improved use of testing. This year, I take great pleasure in giving the award to H.D. Hoover, Professor Emeritus at the University of Iowa. H.D. was the senior author and director of the Iowa Test of Basic Skills. He's a past president of NCME and an author of numerous scholarly articles as well as publications geared to lay audiences. Throughout his career, H.D. has been a tireless proponent of professionally responsible test use and has exposed many common misuses and misinterpretations of test results. Please join me in congratulating H.D. Hoover.
I must admit, I was stunned when I received the letter from Gloria and Felice informing me that I had won the Lindquist Award. However, I doubt if I was as stunned as Lindquist would be if he were still alive. When I was a junior faculty member at Iowa in the late 60s and early 70s, the staff of Iowa Testing met for coffee each morning. On discussions regarding statistics and measurement issues, I listened to what people like Linfeld and Al Hieronymus and Lindquist had to say. Lindquist only asked me questions about golf. That was my only acknowledged area of, anyway, relative expertise. Seriously, I owe my success totally to a group of wonderful colleagues that I've had at Iowa, and to an incredible group of advisees and graduate assistants. I share this honor with them. You know who you are. Thanks.
Okay. The Early Career Award will be presented by Mary E. Dilworth.
Our committee had the opportunity to review an exceptional body of work that was submitted by scholars who are just beginning to show us new perspectives on a variety of important themes, themes like school and community, national policy, teaching and learning, administration, race, and social justice. Kevin Wellner of the University of Colorado at Boulder captured the committee's highest regard by situating a number of these issues in a legal framework. His scholarly contributions allow us to see more clearly the limits and the possibilities of legal remedies for educational dilemmas. We are pleased to recognize Kevin Wellner in this year's early career recipient and look forward to learning a great deal from him in the future. Kevin.
Thank you, Dr. Dilworth. I also want to express my deepest thanks to my colleagues at CU Boulder, especially Lori Shepherd and Ken Howe, who have given me their support and shared wisdom over the past 7 years. My thanks to my various colleagues and co-authors, a group which most recently and prominently includes Carol Burris, Ed Wiley, and Alex Molnar. Finally, I want to express my thanks to Jeannie Oakes, who was my advisor at UCLA, and who, as my advisor, graciously provided me with provided for me a superb model of a morally grounded scholar, and demonstrated that excellent research and a commitment to social justice can go hand in hand. Thank you.
The Outstanding Book Award will be presented by Kathryn M. Anderson-Levitt.
The very thoughtful committee that chose this book for its award included Jabari Mahiri, Walter Parker, Ursula Casanova, and Lynn Goodwin. We reviewed a large set of very fine books, several of them important, that we would recommend you to read, but we honor in particular as the outstanding book of the year in AERA, Equity and Excellence in American Higher Education by William Bowen, Martin Kurzweil, Eugene Tobin, with Suzanne Pichler. It asks this book an important question: when excellent university education really matters to the economic success of both the country and individuals, as well as to our democracy, why do racial and social class gaps in access and in graduation rates persist. It offers sweeping answers based on sound, large database analyzed in historical and cross-national perspective, and it offers a mature and thoughtful answer looking at institutional racism and class bias within society and pointing to actions that we must take now in K-12 education, but also in institutions of higher education. To accept the award on behalf of the authors, I present Martin Kurzweil.
Thank you, Dr. Anderson-Levitt and the selection committee, and thank you to the AERA for this wonderful honor. My co-authors and I were surprised and humbled to learn that we had received the Outstanding Book Award, and needless to say, we were very pleased by the recognition of our work and the further attention to the issues we studied that receiving the award will generate. Research of this scope, our data covered 19 institutions and 190,000 odd student records, is only possible through multiple collaborations that demand trust and goodwill all around. We would like to thank all the institutions and individuals, many of whom are here or represented here, whom together made equity and excellence possible. We hope that this collaborative spirit will continue so that more outcomes research can be conducted. Improving the quality of American higher education and enhancing the openness of educational institutions to young people from all backgrounds will require creative policymaking, political will, and acknowledgement of the critical links between equity and excellence. Our book represents, I think, a gentle push down the path towards achieving this dual goal. And if the award is any indication, it may have resulted in some momentum. Thank you very much for the recognition and the encouragement.
The Committee on Scholars of Color in Education Awards will be presented by Beverly M. Gordon.
Good afternoon. The three awards presented by the AERA Committee on Scholars of Color in Education are intended to recognize scholars of color at different stages in their careers who've made significant contributions to understanding educational, cultural, racial, and political and economic issues which disproportionately affect people of color, and who have made significant contributions to educational research and development. The Distinguished Career Contribution Award is presented to a senior level scholar 20 or 30 years or more after his or her receipt of the doctoral degree. The Committee on Scholars of Color in Education's 2006 Distinguished Career Contribution Award recipient is Professor Sonia Nieto, Professor Emerita of Language, Literacy, and Culture from the University of Massachusetts Amherst. Sonia. Distinguished Scholar Award is presented to a scholar in mid-career who is beyond the first level of professional appointment and for whom 10 or more years have passed since receipt of the doctoral degree. The Committee on Scholars of Color in Education's 2006 Distinguished Scholar Award recipient is Professor Madonna Constantine, Professor in Counseling Psychology, Teachers College, Columbia University. Madonna. Okay. The Early Career Contribution Award is presented to a scholar who is within the first decade of his or her career following the receipt of the doctoral degree. The Committee on Scholars of Color in Education's 2006 Early Career Contribution Award recipients are Greg Tanaka, Assistant Professor in Human Development at Pacific Oaks College in Pasadena, California, and Rich Milner, Assistant Professor in Curriculum and Instruction at Vanderbilt University, Nashville, Tennessee. Rich and Greg. Thank you.
The Social Justice and Education Award will be presented by Carol D. Lee.
The Social Justice in Education Award is given in honor of an individual's outstanding contribution to the advancement of social justice through educational research. We want to thank Dr. Beverly Gordon, the chair of the committee, and Ron Henderson for making this wonderful award. We're honored to present Dr. Gwendolyn Baker, the Social Justice Award in Education. In observance of her many years of service to AERA, and to the field of educational research. Dr. Baker served as the first director of social justice within AERA and actively organized for several decades to move this organization to the forefront of attending to diversity. The very existence of the Social Justice in Action Committee, Scholars of Color, SAGE, and the Minority Fellowship Program are all outgrowths directly or indirectly of Dr. Baker's presence and activism within AERA. We further honor her many years of professional service on behalf of children around the world through her work with UNICEF and the United Nations. We are grateful to stand on the shoulders of the traditions that she has carved out for us to follow. Dr. Baker. Thank you. This is indeed an honor, and I'd like to thank the Social Justice Committee and AERA for allowing me to be the third recipient of this award. But most of all, I'm so pleased to have an opportunity to thank those of you in the audience who have allowed me to work with you over the last 35 years that I have been a member of AERA to help further social justice in AERA and beyond. Thank you.
Special recognition of AERA journal editors and new publications will be presented by Carl A. Grant.
The following individuals are being honored for completing their terms as AERA journal editors. Manette K. Benham for the American Educational Research Journal Section on Social and Institutional Analysis from 2003 to 2005. Margaret D. LeCompte, Review of Educational Research, 2003 to 2005. Thank you.
I can't accept this recognition without thanking Jeanette Klingner, my co-author and mainstay in helping me survive through this term. Thanks, Jeanette.
for the association will honor the editor of an AERA publication released in 2006, Judith L. Green, Gregory Camilla, and Patricia B. Elmore, for the Handbook of Complementary Methods in Education Research.
It happens. I'm calling on my good colleague, Gloria Ladson-Billings. Thank you.
I have the special honor of presenting the special recognition of the annual meeting program chair. There really are no words for me to say how special our relationship is and how hard he has worked. And so I just would like to acknowledge and recognize William F. Tate. I also have the special honor of giving the presidential citation. What's really special about this is that I don't have to have a committee to do it. I can just make the award. And so I'd like to give the presidential citation to Professor Beverly Gordon of The Ohio State University. Recognizes Professor Gordon's outstanding contributions and continuous service to the broad educational research community and to AERA. Most importantly, this citation honors Professor Gordon for her steadfast efforts towards broadening our epistemological perspectives, building an inclusive scholarly community, and mentoring new scholars. Thank Professor you. Gordon.
When Gloria called my office, seems like several weeks ago, she said, girl, just go head on and get a new dress. And I said, you know, usually that comes just before they give you the clock and retire you. And I thought, oh dear, what have I done now? All right, and then she told me that I was going to receive the presidential citation, and I must say to you, Gloria, that I am honored and humbled with this presentation. I want to say to all of you that AERA is not only an institution, it is a community and a family. We have all of our joys and our happiness as well as our corns and our bunions, say the least. Nevertheless, I want to thank this community, my family, if you will, for all that you have given me over the years. You have given me much. And I certainly also want to thank you for allowing me to give you all that I have to give. Thank you. God bless.
The Distinguished Contributions to Research and Education Award will be presented by Suzanne M. Wilson.
I'd like to start by thanking my committee, whose names are in the program, for their good grace, good humor, and hard work in the face of the considerable number of email messages that came from me saying, just one last thing. For his commitment to the development of sophisticated methodological tools and to the use of a broad array of research methodologies. For his scholarly contributions concerning serious social problems, especially his work in child and youth development, communities, and instructional resources and their effects. For his work as an advocate for social justice, including his testimony in the University of Michigan affirmative action cases. And finally, for his work as a caring, committed, inspiring, challenging, and accessible teacher. My committee is honored to award Stephen Rowdenbush the Distinguished Contributions to Educational Research Award. Steve continues to contribute to us all sophisticated tools, substantive work with conceptual clarity and social importance, and next generations of educational researchers who have learned through his model the importance of combining head and heart in education research.
Well, this is really a tremendous thrill, but you have to realize that I've had very good taste in collaborators. 27 years ago, I was a master's student at the Harvard Graduate School of Education, and a boy wonder on the faculty there by the name of Tony Breich told me, Steve, you seem to have a flair for quantitative social science. Why don't you come back next year and be a doctoral student, which I had prior to that no intention of doing. And thus began a lifelong partnership and friendship, and it continues on, and I can hardly thank Tony enough. Other key collaborators, Brian Rowan, University of Michigan, who taught me most of what I know about school organization, David Cohen and Deborah Ball, who taught me much of what I know about instruction, Doug Wilms, University of New Brunswick, School Effects, Xiaofeng Liu, University of South Carolina, experimental design, and most recently, Guanglei Hong, University of Toronto, from whom I've learned a great deal about causal inference. And of course, I especially want to thank my late wife, Stella, whose love, inspiration, and ideas make it possible for me to carry on my work. Thank you.
In 1892, renowned educator and social activist Anna Julia Cooper penned a document entitled, What Are We Worth? Throughout her text, she presses the matter, what are we worth? The analysis raises fundamental questions about race relations, poverty, labor, capital, and human development, offering a bottom line economic argument about the value of education. Cooper stated, education, then, is the safest and richest investment possible to man. It pays the largest dividends and gives the grandest possible product to the world, a man. The demand is always greater than the supply, and the world pays well for what it prizes. Hermeneutically speaking, Cooper used the term man to describe both men and women. In this time period, a call to educate both men and women, black and white, poor and rich, was not a trivial declaration. Moreover, the intersections of gender and race deeply ingrained her rights discourse. It represented cutting-edge public interest argumentation. Throughout her argument, Cooper appealed to basic economic instincts. She made important links among the community, national politics, and international data to better understand the plight and possibilities for blacks and other demographic groups. As a teacher and school principal, Cooper believed all students could succeed. She resisted the vocational trends advanced for by Booker T. Washington and instead insisted on preparing students for college. She prepared many students for study at prominent universities and colleges such as Harvard, Brown, Oberlin, Yale, Amherst, Dartmouth, and Radcliffe. Additionally, Cooper's writing suggests she saw herself as part of the community and teaching as a significant contribution to community development. For those of you familiar with the scholarship of Gloria Ladson-Billings, you may have already identified three tenets of culturally relevant pedagogy in my description of Anna Julia Cooper. If you did not recognize the tenets, then I strongly urge you read her book, The Dream Keepers, Successful Teachers of African American Children. Her research and book examine effective teaching for African American students and how such teaching has helped students achieve academically, but also develop positive identities as African Americans. Like Anna Julia Cooper before her, Gloria Ladson-Billings has not been satisfied with careful scholarly descriptions of success. Please understand my point. I can attest to the fact that she enjoys research in the scholarly life, but her primary focus is not the research or subject matter. Rather, her primary concern has been on helping others understand the value of children and doing what is best for them, education research in the public interest. Thus, the logic associated with her next major project is transparent. If we can describe attributes of effective pedagogy with African American students, under what conditions can we prepare teachers to operate in a manner consistent with effective practice in diverse educational settings? Her book, Crossing Over to Canaan, documents the journey of new teachers in diverse classrooms as part of a change strategy to reform teacher education. I personally observed the co-laborers in this effort and can say candidly they did the work at great cost individually and collectively. Anna Julia Cooper might ask, what are we worth? Crossing Over to Canaan makes clear that the community commitment, intellectual integrity, and educational design produced by serious teacher educators are worth a great deal. Continuing her contribution to the teacher education literature and beyond the Big House, Gloria Ladson-Billings explores the thinking, experiences, and lived realities of African-American educators who have engaged the teacher education process. Her characterizations of African-American educators juxtapose historical figures with contemporary academics. I'm Nat Turner. Her method of analysis motivated this introduction. In addition to book projects, her theoretical contributions to education are numerous. Gloria Ladson-Billings has authored numerous articles and with Carl Grand an edited book that provides additional conceptual clarity to multicultural education. Her theoretical work focused on critical race theory and on culturally relevant pedagogy is widely cited and discussed. Her research and theoretical contributions have been recognized by peers. Currently, the Kellner Family Professor in Urban Education at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, she has been the recipient of several association-wide awards, including the Palmer O. Johnson Award and the Early Career Award. Additionally, she has been a senior fellow in urban education at the Annenberg Institute of School Reform at Brown University. In the spring of 2005, Dr. Ladson-Billings was elected to membership in the National Academy of Education. Her service and contributions to the American Education Research Association have been significant and represent a model for supporting and providing leadership in a professional society. I began this introduction with a discussion of Anna Julia Cooper. When asked in 1930 to describe her vocation, she responded with a simple statement that reflects the essence of this year's annual meeting program theme, Education Research in the Public Interest. She answered, "The education of neglected people." This was her life's work. It is with great pleasure that I introduce our association president, a woman dedicated to research and practice focused on the education of neglected people, Gloria Ladson-Billings.
Thank you. It's a little scary to have someone who knows you well introduce you. You worry that they may share some of your more embarrassing moments. Before I begin, I have to acknowledge a number of people who helped make this evening possible. First, I'd like to thank our executive director, Felice Levine, and the wonderful professional staff at AERA. They make putting on an annual meeting of this size and scope seem effortless. I want to thank the AERA elected and appointed leadership, our executive board, our council, and committee members who made me seem like I knew what I was doing. I also have to thank the scores of friends and colleagues whose support over the years has been vital to my scholarly development. This includes faculty from the University of Melbourne, the London Institute of Education, Umeå University in Sweden, and of course, the faculty, staff, and students from the School of Education of the best university on the face of the earth, the University of Wisconsin. Go Badgers! I want to give some specific thanks to colleagues Michael Apple, Carl Grant, Beth Grau, Tom Popkowitz, and Bill Tate for their feedback on earlier drafts of this address. I also want to thank Alex Molnar and the Ed Policy Research Unit at Arizona State University for substantive critique and ideas. And I want to thank the colleagues from the research focus on black education who have regularly admonished me to keep it real. Of course, the real acknowledgement must go to those people in my life who love and support me, not because I am a scholar or AERA president. They are the people who support me just because I'm me. They include a number of friends from the Bay Area who are here this evening, I hope, and my brother, his wife, my sons, daughter-in-law, and grandchildren. Chief among my support system is the kindest, most understanding partner anyone could have, my husband. Because they are not AERA regulars, I would like them to stand so you can see how special they are. Now, the only people who have permission to leave are my grandchildren. If it get boring, y'all can leave. I have spent the better part of this year reading the presidential addresses of a number of former AERA presidents. Most take the wise course of giving addresses about those things they know well, their own research. Of course, I was not fully persuaded by their wisdom. Instead, I attempted to learn something new, and you, unfortunately, have to determine whether I learned it well enough to share it with you tonight. On the most superficial level, I hope that I can say what I think I've learned in ways that are clear and unambiguous. The English language can be deceiving and unforgiving. For example, I could say, I want to say I love you. I can't stop thinking you are the most beautiful person in the world. But with some slight punctuation changes, those words could come out. I want to say I love you. I can't stop thinking you are the most beautiful person in the world. Let's hope my articulation does not lead to that much confusion. The questions that plague me about education research are not new ones. I'm concerned about the meaning of our work for the larger public, for real students, real teachers and administrators, parents, policymakers, communities in real school settings. I know that these are not new concerns. Since people like the late Kenneth B. Clark was one of the first social scientists to bring his work to the public in a meaningful way in the 1950s. His work with his wife and colleague Mamie formed the basis for the landmark Brown versus Board of Education case that reversed legal segregation in public schools and other public accommodations. However, in his classic volume, Dark Ghetto, Dilemmas of Social Power, first published in 1965, Clark took social scientists to task for their failure to fully engage and understand the plight of the poor. To my knowledge, he says, there is at present nothing in the vast literature of social science treatises and textbooks, and nothing in the practical and field training of graduate students in social science to prepare them for the realities and complexities of this type of involvement in a real, dynamic, turbulent, and at times seemingly chaotic community. And what is more, nothing anywhere in the training of social scientists, teachers, or social workers now prepares them to understand, to cope with, or to change the normal chaos of ghetto communities. These are grave lacks which must be remedied soon if these disciplines are to become relevant to the stability and survival of our society. Clark's concern still remains some 40 years later. However, the paradox is that education research has devoted a significant amount of its enterprise towards the investigation of the poor, African American, Latinos, American Indian, and Asian immigrant students who represent an increasing number of the students in major metropolitan school districts. We seem to study them, but rarely provide the kind of remedies that help them solve their problems. To be fair, education researchers must have the freedom to pursue basic research just as their colleagues in other social sciences do. They must be able to ask questions and pursue inquiries just because. However, because education is an applied field, a field that local states manage and declare must be available to the entire public, most of the questions education researchers ask and need answered are need to be the questions that address the significant questions that challenge and confine the public. We don't need this slide up. Why don't children learn to read? What accounts for the high levels of school dropout among urban students? How can we explain the declining performance in mathematics? How can we explain the declining performance in mathematics and science at the same time that science and mathematics knowledge is exploding? Why do factors like race and class continue to be strong predictors of achievement? One of the most common phrases in today's educational literature is the achievement gap. The term produces more than 11 million citations on the search engine Google. Achievement gap, like certain popular culture music stars, has become a crossover hit. It has made its way into common parlance and everyday usage. The term is invoked by people on both ends of the political spectrum, and few argue over its meaning or its import. According to the National Governors Association, the achievement gap is, and I quote, a matter of race and class, and across the U.S., a gap persists between minority and disadvantaged students and their white counterparts. It further states that this is one of the most pressing education policy challenges that states currently face. The story of the achievement gap is a familiar one. The numbers speak for themselves. In the 2005 National Assessment of Educational Progress results, the gaps between black and Latino fourth graders and their white counterparts in reading was more than 26 points. In fourth grade mathematics, the gap was more than 20 points. In eighth grade reading, the gap was more than 23 points. And in eighth grade mathematics, the gap was more than 26 points. We can also see that these gaps persist over time. Even when we compare African Americans and Latinos with comparable incomes as whites, there is still an achievement gap as measured by standardized testing. And while I focus primarily on showing this gap via standardized test scores, it also exists when comparing dropout rates, relative numbers of students taking advanced placement examinations, those who enroll in honors, AP, and gifted classes, and those who are admitted to colleges, graduate, and professional programs. Scholars have offered a variety of explanations for the existence of this gap. In the 1960s, scholars identified cultural deficit theories to suggest that children of color were victims of pathological lifestyles that hindered their ability to benefit from schooling. The 1966 Coleman Report, Equality of Educational Opportunity, touted the importance of placing students in racially integrated classrooms. Some scholars took that report to further endorse the cultural deficit theories and to suggest that there was not much that could be done by schools to improve the achievement of African American children. But Coleman was subtler than that. He was arguing that a combination of factors was actually more heavily correlated with academic achievement than material resources. Instead, his work indicated that the actual composition of the school, that is, who was attending it, students' sense of their control of the environments and their futures, the teachers' verbal skills, and their family background, all contribute to student achievement. Unfortunately, it is this last factor, family background, that became the primary point of interest for many school and social policies. Social psychologist Claude Steele argues that stereotype threat contributes to the gap. Social linguists such as Kathryn Owl, Lisa Delpit, Michelle Foster, Shirley Bryce Heath, and education researchers such as Jacqueline Jordan Irvine and Carol Lee have focused on the cultural mismatch that contributes to the gap. Multicultural education researchers like James Banks, Geneva Gay, and Carl Grant, and curriculum theorists like Michael Apple, Catherine Kornbleth, and Thomas Popkiewicz have focused on the nature of the curriculum and school as sources of the gap. And teacher educators such as Christine Sleater, Marilyn Cochran Smith, Kenneth Zeitner, and myself have focused on the pedagogical practices of teachers as contributing to either the exacerbation or narrowing of the gap. But I want to take this opportunity to call into question the wisdom of focusing on the achievement gap as a way of explaining and understanding the persistent inequality that exists and has always existed in our nation's schools. I want to argue that this all-out focus on the achievement gaps moves us towards short-term solutions that are unlikely to address the long-term underlying problem. Let me begin this next section with a strange transition from a familiar piece of children's literature. Alice started to her feet, for it flashed across her mind that she had never before seen a rabbit with either a waistcoat pocket or a watch to take out of it. And burning with curiosity, she ran across the field after it, and fortunately was just in time to see it pop down a large rabbit hole under the hedge. In another moment, down went Alice after it, never once considering how in the world she was to get out again. The relevance of this passage is that I, like Alice, saw a rabbit with a watch and a waistcoat pocket when I came across a book by economist Robert Marco entitled Race and Schooling in the American South, 1880 to 1950. And like Alice, I chased the rabbit called economics down the rabbit hole where the world looks very different to me. Fortunately, I have traveled there with my trusty copy of Lakoff and Johnson's Metaphors We Live By as a way to make sense of my sojourn there. So before I make my way back to the challenge of school inequality, I beg your indulgence as I give you a brief tour of my time down the rabbit hole. If you're like me, you hear or read news of the economy every day and rarely give it a second thought. You hear that the Federal Reserve Bank is raising interest rates or that the unemployment numbers look good. Your ears may perk up when you hear the latest gasoline prices or that you can get a good rate on a mortgage refinance loan. But busy professionals rarely have time to delve deeply into all things economic. Two economic terms, national deficit and national debt, seem to befuddle us. The deficit is the amount by which a government, company, or individual spending exceeds its income over a particular period of time. Thus, each budget cycle, the government must determine whether it has a balanced budget, a budget surplus, or a deficit. The debt, however, is the sum of all previously incurred annual federal deficits. Since the deficits are financed by government borrowing, national debt is equal to all government debt. Now, most fiscal conservatives warn against deficit budgets and urge the government to decrease its spending to balance the budget. Fiscal liberals do not necessarily embrace deficits, but would rather see the budget balanced by increasing tax revenues on those most able to pay. The debt is a sum that has been accumulating since 1791, when the U.S. Treasury recorded it as $75,463,476.52. Thomas Jefferson said, "I place economy among the first and most important virtues, and public debt as the greatest of dangers. To preserve our independence, we must not let our rulers load us with perpetual debt." But the debt has not merely been going up. Between 1823 and 1835, the debt was steadily decreasing from a high of almost $91 million to a low of $33,733.05. The national debt hit the $1 billion mark in 1863 and the $1 trillion mark in 1981. Today, the national debt sits at more than $8 trillion. This level of debt means that the U.S. pays about $132,844,673 $701,219.88 in interest every year. This makes our debt interest the third largest expenditure in the federal budget after defense and combined entitlement programs such as Social Security and Medicare. Even in those years when the U.S. had a balanced budget, that is, no deficits, the national debt continued to grow. It may have grown at a slower rate, but it did continue to grow. President Clinton bragged about presenting a balanced budget, one without deficits, and not growing the debt. However, the debt was already at a frighteningly high level, and his budget policies failed to make a dent in the debt. By now, you might assume that I have made myself firmly at home at the Mad Hatter's Tea Party. What does a discussion about national deficits and national debt have to do with education, education research, and continued education disparities? It is here where I begin to see some metaphorical concurrences between our national fiscal situation and our education situation. I am arguing that our focus on the achievement gap is akin to a focus on the budget deficit. But what is actually happening to African American, Latino, Asian American, immigrant, and Native American students is really more like the national debt. We do not have an achievement gap. We have an education debt. Now, to be perfectly candid, I must admit that when I consulted with a strict economist, Professor Emeritus Robert Haveman of the University of Wisconsin's Department of Economics, the La Follette Institute of Public Affairs, and the Institute for Research on Poverty, he stated, the education debt is the foregone schooling resources that we could have, should have, been investing in primarily low-income kids, which deficit leads to a variety of social programs, things like crime and low productivity, low wages, low labor force participation, that require an ongoing public investment. This required investment sucks away resources that could go to reducing the achievement gap. Without the education debt, we could narrow the achievement gap. The message would be that you need to reduce one, that is the education debt as he defined it, in order to close the other, the achievement gap. A parallel is trying to gain a growing and robust economy with a large national debt overhang. In addition to this informal discussion with Haveman, I read some work of Wolf and Haveman entitled Accounting for the Social and Non-Market Benefits of Education. This is work that catalogs a series of what they term non-market effects of schooling. They contend that the literature on the intergenerational effects of education is generally neglected in assessing the full impact of education. Among the non-market effects they include are a positive link between one's own schooling and the schooling received by one's children, a positive association between schooling and health status of one's family members, a positive relationship between one's own education and one's own health status, a positive relationship between one's own education and the efficiency of choices made, such as consumer choices, a relationship between one's own schooling and fertility choices, in particular decisions of one's female teenage children regarding non-marital childbearing, the relationship between schooling, social capital of one's neighborhood, and youth decisions regarding their level of schooling, non-marital childbearing, and participation in criminal activities. Now, while these economists have informed my thinking, I've taken a somewhat different tack on this notion of the education debt. The yearly fluctuations in the achievement gap give us a short-range picture of how students perform on a particular set of achievement measures. Looking at the gap year to year is a misleading exercise. Lee's look at the trend lines show us that there was a narrowing of the gap in the 1980s between both black, white, and Latino white racial ethnic groups, and a subsequent expanding of the gap between those groups. The expansion of the disparities occurred even though the income differences narrowed during the 1990s. We do not have good answers as to why the gap narrows or widens. Some research suggests that socioeconomic and family conditions, youth culture and student behaviors, or schooling conditions and practices do not fully explain changes in the achievement gap. However, when you begin looking at the construction and compilation of what I've termed the education debt, you can better understand why an achievement gap is a logical outcome. I am arguing that the historical, economic, sociopolitical, and moral decisions and policies that characterize our society have created an education debt. So from this point, I want to briefly describe each of those aspects of the debt. Scholars in the history of education like James Anderson, Michael Fultz, David Tyack, have documented the legacy of educational inequity in the U.S. Those inequities initially were formed around race, class, and gender. Gradually, some of those inequities began to recede, but clearly they persist in the realm of race. In the case of African American education, education was initially forbidden during the period of enslavement. After emancipation, we saw the development of freedmen's schools, whose purpose was the maintenance of a servant class. During the long period of legal apartheid, African Americans attended schools where they received cast-off textbooks and materials from white schools. In the rural South, the need for farm labor meant that the typical school year for rural black students was about 4 months. Indeed, black students in the South did not experience universal secondary schooling until the 1960s. Why, then, would we not expect there to be an achievement gap? The history of American Indian education is equally egregious. It began with mission schools to convert and use Indian labor to further the cause of the church. Later, boarding schools were developed as General George Pratt asserted the need to, quote, kill the Indian in order to save the man. This strategy of deliberate and forced assimilation created a group of people, according to Pulitzer Prize winner M. Scott Momaday, who belonged nowhere. The assimilated Indian could not fit comfortably into reservation life or the stratified mainstream. No predominantly white colleges welcomed the few Indians that successfully completed the early boarding schools. Only historically black colleges like Hampton Institute opened their doors to them. There they studied a vocational and trade curriculum. Latino students also experienced huge disparities in their education. In Ferg Kadima's report, Black, White, and Brown, Latino school desegregation efforts in the pre- and post-Brown v. Board of Education era, we discover the long-standing practice of denial experienced by Latinos dating back to 1848. Historic desegregation cases such as Mendez versus Westminster and the Lemon Grove incident detail the ways that Brown children were and continue to be excluded from equitable and high-quality education. It is important to point out that the historical debt was not merely imposed by ignorant masses who were xenophobic or virulently racist. The major leaders of the nation endorsed ideas about their inferiority. Thomas Jefferson, who advocated for the education of the American citizen, simultaneously decried the notion that blacks were capable of education. George Washington, while deeply conflicted about slavery, maintained a substantial number of slaves on his Mount Vernon plantation and gave no thought to educating enslaved children. A brief perusal of some of the history of public schooling in the U.S. documents the way that we have accumulated an education debt over time. In 1827, Massachusetts passed a law making all grades of public school open to all pupils free of charge. At about this same time, most southern states already had laws forbidding the teaching of Africans who were enslaved to read. By 1837, when Horace Mann had become head of the newly formed Massachusetts State Board of Education, Edmund Dwight, a wealthy Boston industrialist, felt that the state board was crucial to factory owners and offered to supplement the state salary with his own money. What is omitted from this history is that the major raw material of those textile factories that drove the economy of the East was cotton, the crop that depended primarily on the free labor of enslaved Africans. Thus, one of the ironies of the historical debt is that while African Americans were enslaved and prohibited from schooling, the product of their labor was used to profit northern industrialists who already had the benefits of education. Consider the real source of New England's wealth. By 1860, New England was home to 472 cotton mills built on rivers and streams throughout the region. Just between 1830 and 1840, northern mills consumed more than 100 million pounds of southern cotton, with shipping and manufacturing included. The economy of much of New England was connected to textiles. By the 1850s, the enormous profits of the Massachusetts industrialists had been poured into a complex network of banks, insurance companies, and railroads. But their wealth remained anchored to dozens of mammoth textile mills in Massachusetts, southern Maine, and New Hampshire. This pattern of debt impacted other groups as well. In 1864, the United States Congress made it illegal for Native Americans to be taught in their native languages. After the Civil War, African Americans worked with Republicans to rewrite state constitutions to guarantee free public education for all students. Unfortunately, their efforts benefited white children more than black children. The landmark Plessy v. Ferguson decision meant that the segregation that the South had been practicing was officially recognized as legal by the federal government. Now, while the historical debt is a heavy one, it's important not to overlook the ways that communities of colors have always worked to educate themselves. Between 1865 and 1877, African Americans mobilized to bring public education to the South for the first time. Carter G. Woodson was a primary critic of the kind of education African Americans received and challenged African Americans to develop schools and curriculum that met the unique needs of a population only a few generations out of chattel slavery. As is often true of social research, numbers present startling pictures of reality. So as I segue to the economic debt, the economics of the education debt are sobering. The funding disparities that currently exist between schools serving white students and those serving students of color are not recent phenomena. Separate schooling always allows for differential funding. In current day dollars, the funding disparities between urban schools and their suburban counterparts presents a telling story about the value we place on the education of different groups of students. $1,299 per pupil for its 79% black and Latino population, while across City Line Avenue in Lower Marion, the per pupil expenditure is $17,261 for a 91% white population. New York City Public Schools spends $11,627 per pupil for a student population that is 72% black and Latino, while suburban Manhasset spends $22,311 for a student population that is 91% white. Now, one of the earliest things that one learns in statistics is that correlation does not prove causation. But we must ask ourselves why the funding inequities map so neatly and regularly onto the racial and ethnic realities of our schools. Even if we cannot prove that schools are poorly funded because black and Latino students attend them, we can demonstrate that the amount of funding rises with the rise in white students. This pattern of inequitable funding has occurred over centuries. For many of these populations, schooling was non-existent during the early history of the nation, and clearly whites were not prepared to invest their fiscal resources in these strange others. Another important part of the economic component of the education debt is the earning ratios related to years in schooling. The empirical data suggests that more schooling is associated with higher earnings. That is, high school graduates earn more money than high school dropouts, and college graduates earn more than high school graduates. Marco pointed out that in 1940, the average annual earnings of black men was about 48% of those of white men. But by 1980, the earning ratio had risen to 61%. By 1993, the median black male earned 74% as much as the median white male. Now, while earnings ratios show us how people are or were doing at particular points in time, they do not address the cumulative effect of such income disparities. According to economists Joseph Altonji and Ulrich Dorzleski, the wealth gap between whites and blacks in the United States is much larger than the gap in earning. The gap in wealth has implications for the social positions of African Americans that go far beyond its obvious implications for consumption levels that households can sustain. This is because wealth is a source of political and social power, influences access to capital for new businesses, and provides insurance against fluctuations in labor market income. It affects the quality of housing, neighborhoods, and schools a family has access to, as well as the ability to finance higher education. The fact that friendships and family ties tend to be within racial groups amplifies the effect of the wealth gap on the financial, social, and political resources available to blacks relative to white. This economic analysis maps well onto the notions of achievement gap versus education debt that I'm trying to advance. So while the income gap more closely resembles the achievement gap, the wealth disparity better reflects the education debt I am attempting to describe. Let's talk about the socio-political debt, because it reflects the degree to which communities of color are excluded from the civic process. Black, Latino, Native communities, Asian immigrants had little or no access to the franchise, so they had no true legislative representation. According to the United States Department of Justice Civil Rights Division, African Americans and other persons of color were substantially disenfranchised in many southern states despite the enactment of the 15th Amendment in 1870. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 is touted as the most successful piece of civil rights legislation ever adopted by the U.S. Congress. This act represents a proactive attempt to eradicate the socio-political debt that had been accumulating since the founding of the nation. So this table that will come up shows you the sharp contrast between voter registration rates before the Voting Rights Act of 1865 and after it. The dramatic changes in voter registration are a result of Congress's bold action in upholding the constitutionality of the act. The Supreme Court ruled Congress has found that the case-by-case litigation was inadequate to combat widespread and persistent discrimination in voting because of the inordinate amount of time and energy required to overcome the obstructionist tactics invariably encountered in these lawsuits. After enduring nearly a century of systematic resistance to the 15th Amendment, Congress might well decide to shift the advantage of time and inertia from the perpetuators of the evil to its victims. It is hard to imagine such a dramatic and drastic action on the behalf of African American, Latino, and American Indian children in schools. For example, imagine that an examination of the achievement performance of children of color provoked an immediate reassignment of the nation's best teachers to the schools serving the most needy students. Imagine that those same students were guaranteed places in state and regional colleges and universities. Imagine that within one generation, we lift those students out of poverty. The closest example that we have of such a dramatic policy move is that of affirmative action. Rather than wait for students of color to meet predetermined standards, the society decided to recognize that historically denied groups should be given a preference in admission to schools and colleges. Ultimately, the major beneficiaries of this policy were white women, as it would be because of the sheer numbers. However, Bowen and Bach found that in the case of African Americans, this proactive policy help create what we now know as the black middle class. As a result of the socio-political component of the education debt, families of color have regularly been excluded from the decision-making mechanisms that ensure that their children receive quality education. The parent-teacher organizations, school site councils, and other possibilities for democratic participation have not been available for many of these families. However, for a brief moment in 1968, black parents in the Ocean Hill-Brownsville section of New York exercised community control over the public schools. Thus, African Americans, Latino, Native American, and Asian American parents have often advocated for improvements in schooling, but their advocacy often has been muted and marginalized. The quest for control of schools was powerfully captured in the voice of an African American mother during the fight for school desegregation in Boston, who declared, "When we fight about schools, we're fighting for our lives." Indeed, a major component of the modern civil rights movement was the quest for quality schooling. From Benjamin Rushing in 1849 to rural districts in South Carolina in 1999, families of color have been fighting for quality education for their children. Their more limited access to lawyers and legislators have kept them from accumulating the kind of political capital that their white middle-class counterparts have. A final component of the education debt is what I term the moral debt. I find this concept difficult to explain since social science rarely talks in these terms. What I did find in the literature was the concept of moral panics that was popularized in British sociology. Moral panics attempt to describe people, groups of individuals, or events that have become defined as threats throughout society. However, the supposed threat overshadows the real magnitude of the threat posed. Stanley Cohen, author of the classic sociological treatment on moral panics, Folk Devils and Moral Panics, defined the term as a condition, episode, person or group of persons that emerges to become defined as a threat to societal values and interests. Its nature is presented in a stylized and stereotypical fashion by the mass media. The moral barricades are manned by editors, bishops, politicians, and other right-thinking people. Socially accredited experts pronounce their diagnosis and solutions. Ways of coping are evolved or resorted to. The condition then disappears, submerges, or deteriorates and becomes more visible. Sometimes the subject of the panic passes over and is forgotten, except in folklore and collective memory. At other times, it has more serious and long-lasting repercussions and might produce such changes as those in legal and social policy, or even in the way society conceives itself. But a moral debt is that aspect of that debt that reflects the disparity between what we know is right and what we actually do. St. Thomas Aquinas saw that the moral debt was what human beings owe to each other in the giving of or failure to give honor to another when honor is due. This honor comes as a result of people's excellence or because of what they've done for another. We have no trouble recognizing that we have a moral debt to Rosa Parks, or Martin Luther King, or Cesar Chavez, or Elie Wiesel, or Mahatma Gandhi. But how do we recognize the moral debt we owe to entire groups of people? How do we calculate such a debt? Now, typically, we think of moral debt as relational between nation states. For example, at the end of World War II, Israel charged Germany not only with a fiscal or monetary debt, but also with a moral debt. On the individual level, Fred Korematsu battled the United States government for 40 years to prove that Japanese Americans were owed a moral debt. In another 40-year time span, the U.S. government ran a study of syphilis patients withholding treatment after a known cure was discovered and was forced to acknowledge its ethical breaches. In his 1997 apology to the survivors and the families, President Bill Clinton said, and I quote, "The United States government did something that was wrong, deeply, profoundly, morally wrong. It was an outrage to our commitment to integrity and equality of all citizens, clearly racist. Today, all human subjects protocols reflect the moral debt that we owe to the victims of that study." David Gill asserts in his book, Being Good, "We are living today in an ethical wilderness, a wild, untamed, unpredictable landscape. Thus, we bemoan the loss of civil discourse and rational debate. But the real danger of our discussions about morality is that they reside solely in the realm of the individual. We want people to take personal responsibility for their behavior, personal responsibility for their health care, personal responsibility for their welfare, and personal responsibility for their education. However, in democratic nations, that personal responsibility must also be coupled with social responsibility. What is it that we might owe citizens who have historically been excluded from social benefits and opportunities? Randall Robinson states, "No nation can enslave a race of people for hundreds of years, set them free, bedraggled and penniless, pit them without assistance in a hostile environment against privileged victimizers, and then reasonably expect the gap between the heirs of the two groups to narrow. Lines begun parallel and left alone can never touch. Robinson's sentiments were not unlike those of President Lyndon Johnson, who in an address to Howard University in 1965 stated, and I quote, "You cannot take a man who has been in chains for 300 years, remove the chains, take him to the starting line, and tell him to run the race, and think that you are being fair." Despite those parallel lines of which Robinson spoke, in the midst of the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln noted that without the 200,000 black men who enlisted in the Union Army, quote, "we would be compelled to abandon the war in 3 weeks." Thus, according to historian Ron Takaki, black men in blue made the difference in determining that this government of the people, by the people, for the people, did not perish from the earth. What moral debt do we owe their heirs? When we hear the word plantation, our mind almost automatically reflects back to the antebellum South. However, the same word evokes the Palolo Valley on the island of Oahu in Hawaii, where there were camps named Young He, Ah Fong, Spanish A, Spanish B, and Alabama. This last camp, Alabama, was a Hawaiian plantation worked by black laborers. Each of the groups that comprised the Hawaiian plantations, the Native Hawaiians, the Chinese, the Japanese, the Filipinos, the Koreans, the Portuguese, the Puerto Ricans, and the blacks, worked the sugar economy that sated a worldwide sweet tooth. What do we owe their descendants? And perhaps our largest moral debt is to the indigenous peoples whose presence was all but eradicated from the nation. In its 2000 In its 2004-05 report card, the Bureau of Indian Affairs indicates that its high school graduation rate is 57%, with only 3.14% of its students performing at the advanced level in reading and 3.96% performing at the advanced level in mathematics. 122 of the 185 elementary and secondary schools under the jurisdiction of the Bureau of Indian Affairs failed to meet average yearly progress in the 2004-2005 year. The NCES report on the status and trends in the education of American Indians and Alaskan Natives indicates that the dropout rate among this population is about 15% higher than that of whites, blacks, and Asian Pacific Islanders. Only 26% of American Indians and Alaskan Natives completed a core academic track in 2000, while 57% of Asian Pacific Islanders, 38% of Latinos, 44% of African Americans, and 48% of whites completed core academic tracks during that same year. Taken together, the historic, economic, sociopolitical, and moral debt we have amassed towards African American, Latino, Asian American, and Native American children seems insurmountable, and attempts at addressing it seem futile. Indeed, it appears like a task for Sisyphus. But as legal scholar Derek Bell indicated, just because something is impossible does not mean it is not worth doing. In the final section of this talk, I'd like to address why we must address the education debt. And on the face of it, we must address it because it's the equitable and just thing to do. As Americans, we pride ourselves with maintaining those ideal qualities as hallmarks of our democracy. This represents the highest motivation for paying this debt. But we do not always work from our highest motivations. Most of us live in the world of the pragmatic and practical. So we must address the education debt because it has implications for the kinds of lives that we can live and the kind of education the society can expect for most of its children. I want to suggest that there are three primary reasons for addressing the debt: the impact that the debt has on present education progress, the value of understanding the debt in relation to past education research findings, and the potential for forging a better educational future. As late as the 19th of March, I was still tinkering with this address. While sitting in the airport in Cleveland, Ohio, I came across a news article in the business section of the Cleveland Plain Dealer that indicated that affluent investors were more likely to be educated, married men. The article continued by talking about how whites made up 88% of the wealthy investor households, while blacks and Latinos made up only 3% of affluent investors. Asian Americans, who are 3.7% of the adult population, are 5% of the wealthy investors. But more salient than wealthy investor status to me was a quote from former Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan: "My biggest fear for this country's future, competitively speaking, is that we're doing a poor job in education. If we can resolve our educational problems, I think we will maintain the very extraordinary position the United States holds in the world at large." As I was attempting to make sense of this deficit debt metaphor, educational economist Doug Harris reminded me that when nations operate with large debt, some part of their current budget goes to service that debt. As I mentioned earlier, that interest payments on our national debt represent the third largest expenditure of our national budget. In the case of education, each effort that we make towards improving education is counterbalanced by the ongoing and mounting debt that we've accumulated. That debt service manifests itself in the distrust and suspicion about what schools can and will do in communities serving the poor and children of color. Breich and Schneider identified relational trust as a key component in school reform. I argue that the magnitude of the education debt erodes the trust and represents a portion of the debt service that teachers and administrators pay each year against what they might rightfully invest in helping students to advance academically. The second reason we must address the debt is somewhat selfish from an education research perspective. Much of our scholarly effort has gone into looking at educational inequality and how we might mitigate it. Despite how hard we try, there are two interventions that have never received full and sustained hypothesis testing: school desegregation and funding equity. Orfield and Lee point out that not only has school segregation persisted, it has been transformed by the changing demographics of the nation. They also point out that there has not been a serious discussion of the cost of segregation or the advantages of integration for our most segregated population, white students. So while we may have recently celebrated the 50th anniversary of Brown, we can point to little evidence that we really gave Brown a chance. According to Frankenberg, Lee and Orfield, and Orfield and Lee, America's public schools are more than a decade into a process of resegregation. Almost three-fourths of black and Latino students attend schools that are predominantly non-white. More than 2 million black and Latino students, a quarter of the black students in the Northeast and the Midwest, attend what the researchers call apartheid schools. The four most segregated states for black children are New York, Michigan, Illinois, and California. The funding equity problem, as I illustrated earlier in this discussion, also has been intractable. In its report, The Funding Gap 2005, the Education Trust tells us that in 27 of the 49 states studied, the highest poverty school districts received fewer resources than the lowest poverty districts. Even more states shortchanged their highest minority districts. In 30 states, high minority districts received less money for each child than low minority districts. If we are unwilling to desegregate our schools and unwilling to fund them equitably, we find ourselves not only backing away from the promise of the Brown decision, but literally refusing to even take Plessy seriously. At least a serious consideration of Plessy would make us look at funding inequities. In one of the most graphic examples of funding inequity that I've seen recently, new teacher Sarah Centilles describes a Southern California school where she was teaching. This is a quote from Sarah. At Garvey Elementary School, I taught over 30 second graders in a so-called temporary building. Most of these temporary buildings had been on campuses in Compton for years. The one I taught in was old. Because the wooden beams across the ceiling were being eaten by termites, a fine layer of wood dust covered the students' desks every morning. Maggots crawled in a cracked and collapsing area in the floor near my desk. One day after school, I went to sit in my chair, and it was completely covered in maggots. I was nearly sick. Mice ran behind cupboards and bookcases. I trapped six in terrible traps called glue lounges, given to me by the custodians. The blue metal window coverings on the outsides of the windows were shut permanently, blocking all sunlight. Someone had lost the tool needed to open them, and no one could find another. Rothstein and Wilder have moved beyond the documentation of the inequalities and inadequacies to looking at their consequences. So in the language that I am using, they move from focusing on the gap to tallying the debt. Although they focus on black-white disparities, they are clear that similar disparities exist between Latinos and whites and Native Americans and whites. Contrary to conventional wisdom, Rothstein and Wilder argue that addressing the achievement gap is not the most important inequality to attend to. Rather, they contend that inequalities in health, early childhood experiences, out-of-school experiences, and economic security are also contributory and cumulative and make it near impossible for us to rectify the achievement gap as the source and cause of social inequality. Finally, we have to address what implications this mounting debt has for our future. In one scenario, we might determine that our debt is so high that the only thing we can do is declare bankruptcy. Perhaps, like our airline industry, we could use the protection of the bankruptcy laws to reorganize and design more streamlined, more efficient school options. Or perhaps we could be like developing nations that owe huge sums to the IMF and apply for 100% debt relief. But what would such a catastrophic collapse of our education system look like? Where could we go to begin from the ground up to build the kind of education system that aggressively addressed the debt? Where might we find a setting where perhaps a catastrophic occurrence, a natural disaster, a hurricane, had completely obliterated the schools? of course, it would need to be a place where the schools weren't very good to begin with. It would have to be a place where our IRB and human subjects concerns do not keep us from proposing aggressive and cutting-edge research. It would have to be a place where people were so desperate for the expertise of education researchers that we could do multiple projects using multiple approaches. It would be a place so hungry for solutions that it would not matter if some projects were quantitative or others were qualitative. It would not matter if some were large scale and some were small scale. It would not matter if some paradigms were psychological and some were social and some were economic or some were cultural. The only thing that would matter in an environment like this would be that education researchers were bringing their expertise to bear on education problems that spoke to the pressing concerns of the public. I wonder where we might find such a place. Although I've tried to explain this notion of education debt, I know that my words are a limited way to fully represent it. How could I illustrate the magnitude of this concept? In his 1993 presidential address, Forms of Understanding in the Future of Educational Research, Elliot Eisner spoke of representation, not as mental representation discussed in cognitive ways, but as an important, he spoke of them not as a mental representation discussed in cognitive science, but as the process of transforming the consciousness into a public form so that they can be stabilized, inspected, edited, and shared with others. I've taken a risk here to construct a set of images that illustrate the debt. They remind us that the cumulative effect of poor education, poor housing, poor health care, poor government services creates a bifurcated society that leaves more than its children behind. They are images that should compel us to deploy our knowledge, skill, and expertise to alleviate the suffering of the least of these.
What has happened down here? Is the wind have changed? Clouds rolling from the north and it's starting to rain. It rained real hard and it rained for a real long time. 6 feet of water in the streets of Evangeline. The river rolls all day, the river rolls all night. Some people got lost in the flood, some people got away all right. The river had busted through, cleared out the plaque of mine. 6 feet of water in the streets of Evangeline, Louisiana. They're trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away. Oh, Louisiana, Louisiana. They're trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away. President Coolidge come down. Railroad train. This fat man with a notepad in his hand. Cause that silly little fat man, oh, isn't it a shame? what the river had done to this poor farmer's land. Oh, Louisiana, Louisiana, it's time to wash us away. Trying to wash us away. Oh, Louisiana, oh, oh, Louisiana, trying to wash us away. Oh, Lord, trying to wash us away. They're trying to wash us away. Trying to wash us away.
I am proud of what AERA has done this year. As a research association in response to the immediate concerns of Hurricane Katrina victims, we found a niche, graduate students in education and other educational researchers who were impacted by the hurricane, and we tried to fill it. We organized a clearinghouse of schools and colleges of education that were willing to provide space for displaced graduate students and education research scholars. We also provided each attendee at the annual meeting with an opportunity to donate to the relief of the hurricane victims. But it is not merely our charitable efforts that need to address this human suffering. We have expertise. We know a lot about education and how it works and does not work. We know things about administration and policy, curriculum and teaching, evaluation and instruction, measurement and counseling, history and organization. And it is that expertise that is desperately needed in the Gulf Coast region. In their recent book, Michael Apple and Kristen Burris suggest that the subaltern can and do speak. In this country, they speak from the barrios of Los Angeles and the ghettos of New York. They speak from the reservations of New Mexico and the Chinatown of San Francisco. They speak from the levee breaks of New Orleans, where they remind us, as education researchers, that we do not merely have an achievement gap. We have an education debt. Thank you. And now I come to the moment I have been waiting for 365 days. I get to introduce and present your 2007 president from the University of California, Los Angeles, Eva Baker.
I had some inane remarks to make, but I can hardly talk. Gloria, that was astonishing. I was going to talk about the standard Gloria had set before I had heard this presentation for scholarship, for focus, for energy, for style, and I wore my Gloria shoes to let you know that I was going to aspire to at least some of her work. I want to congratulate her for not only this, but a whole year before of a terrific presidency. I'm daunted, to say the least. I also would like to thank Marilyn Cochran Smith, who's been giving me help all along. And a welcome to Bill Tate, who I expect to also help. To you, I say thank you. I'm very honored by this opportunity. I'll be grateful for the chance to work with Phoebe and Felice, who have done wonderful things for AERA over the last few years. I need to hear from you, and I have to say I already have quite considerably, about how you think the AERA leadership can help improve the expectations, opportunity, and impact of our research for the kids who most need our help. I do want to thank the enormous number of you who volunteered to serve on committees or have written and said that they were available to help in the next year. As you may know, I have the privilege of working with Dan Koretz of Harvard University, who will be the program chair for the 2007 annual meeting. Together with all of you, we intend next year's meeting to focus on the topic of the world of educational quality, with parallel emphasis on innovations in research from the international community and also the diversity in our own country. For those of you who have difficulty in grappling with what might be meant by the term quality, I suggest a book that's probably out of print, but therefore it will be inexpensive, called Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance. People of my generation will know what that is. At any rate, I will see you all in Chicago. Thank you again.
Thank you for sharing this very special moment with us. There's a reception that follows this particular program. I wish you a wonderful experience as you go forward with your interactions in the program today and going forward the rest of the meeting. Thank you very much.